Please rise. I will make you as a light for the nations. Are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
To God.
you. Let us pray. O God, you know that we are set in the midst of many grave dangers, and because of the frailty of our nature, we cannot always stand upright. Grant that your strength and protection may support us in all dangers and carry us through every temptation, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the lessons.
Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Deuteronomy, the 18th chapter, verses 15 through 22. Deuteronomy 18, verses 15 through 22. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, or see this great fire any more, lest I die." And the Lord said to me, "They are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up from them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die. And if you say in your heart, 'How may we know the word that the Lord has not spoken?' When a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him." The word of the Lord.
Psalm today is Psalm 111. It's found on page 419 in the prayer book, and we also have it in our bulletins. We'll read responsibly by half verse. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks unto the Lord with my whole heart. Company of the upright and among the congregation. The works of the Lord are great, sought out by all who have pleasure in them. His work is worthy to be praised and held in honor. He has made his marvelous works to be had in remembrance. He has given food to those who fear him. He has shown his people the power of his works. The works of his hands are faithfulness and justice. They stand fast forever and ever. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, will be forever. Amen.
Amen. please stand for the gospel entrance?
The gospel reading this morning is from the first chapter of Mark, verses 21 through 28. This is the holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we would see Jesus this morning. Heavenly Father, we would hear Jesus this morning. Heavenly Father, we would be moved to love and to serve Jesus this morning. Amen. You may be seated. On March 30th, 1981, at 2:27 p.m., President Ronald Reagan was returning to his limousine after a speaking engagement at the Washington Hilton Hotel when six shots were fired off at him by a man right in front of him. The final shot ricocheted off the back quarter panel of the limousine that he was riding in, and it hit the president right under his left arm, lodging in his left lung, just an inch away from his heart. He was rushed, of course, to the hospital for emergency surgery, where he would go on to lose half of his blood. But within about 5 minutes of the shooting, members of his cabinet began gathering in the Situation Room, They were initially unsure whether the shooting was part of a larger attack by a foreign intelligence agency, such as the KGB. Tensions with the Soviets were presently high. And since the president was incapacitated, they knew someone had to take charge of the nation that was potentially under threat, and it needed to happen sooner rather than later. Well, succession would normally go to Vice President Bush, but Bush was in the sky over Texas, and they were having trouble communicating with his plane. And so in an effort to try and assuage a frenzied media, the Secretary of State, Alexander Haig, stepped up to the mic and said, "As of now, I am in control of the White House." Some of you may remember that. "Don't worry, as of now, I am in control of the White House." Well, he meant to reassure the nation, but he only created more confusion and anxiety because, according to the Constitution, he was not in charge. Constitutionally, Haig wasn't even second or third in line of succession to the president. He was fourth. So for a while there, no one really knew who was in charge. Our nation was experiencing something of a crisis of authority. Do you ever feel like that? Fearful and anxious about the future, about all that is going on around us? Because it doesn't really seem like anyone's in charge. Who do I look to? Is it the government? Is it the military? Is it the media? Big tech? Big pharma? Who's in charge? That's the greatest question of our time. It is the question of authority. The great Dutch statesman and theologian Abraham Kuyper said this: "There is not a square inch in the whole domain of our human existence over which Christ does not cry out, 'Mine.'" And Jesus himself said in his Great Commission, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given unto me." And I'd be willing to say that most of our anxiety and most of our fear in life comes from the fact that we don't really believe that. That we don't really believe Jesus is in charge. Well, our gospel passage this morning is designed to show us just that, that Jesus is in charge. And he demonstrates why you and I ought to believe it in two ways here. Two ways. So first, by the authority of his words. And second, by the authority of his actions. The authority of his words and the authority of his actions. So by the authority of his words, well, by this time, Jesus had been anointed by the Holy Spirit at his baptism, and he had just got done calling his first four disciples, whom he found fishing alongside the Sea of Galilee. And today, he takes them into the classroom, so to speak, for the very first lesson. And what was that? Look with me at verses 21 and 22. "And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes." Jesus took his disciples over into Capernaum on the north side of the Sea of Galilee into an area that would sort of become for them a home base for ministry in the land of Israel. When I was in North Africa in 2008, I was working with a team of missionaries, and we were ministering to Muslims all over the country that we were in. But we always made our way back to one particular seaside town to kind of lay low and rest before launching back into the coming weeks of ministry, which were so often emotionally draining and spiritually draining. And throughout his ministry, Jesus and his disciples would treat Capernaum in a very similar way. It was their home base. So it's proper that Jesus take these first disciples here first. And we're told that as soon as he entered this town with these four new disciples, kind of still wet behind the ears, He went into the local synagogue and he began teaching. And it says the people were astonished at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. Now, what causes people to recognize the authority of Jesus' preaching? Was it because he exercised all the best rhetorical devices of the day? No. Was it because he told them everything that their itching ears wanted to hear, like the prosperity preachers of our own day do? No, it wasn't that. Was it because he was the smartest person they ever met? Well, yes, he was, but that's not the reason. And what was it? Well, you see, the scribes and the Pharisees were often really intelligent, but their preaching was more like an academic essay. Their method was something like, Rabbi Hillel says this, but Rabbi Shammai says this, and somebody else says this, and so there's a consensus on this point here, and so this is what it must mean. Their preaching was a sort of secondhand theology, and it was derived from the traditions of their own rabbinical heroes and their writings. All our denominations have their heroes too, don't we? And we preachers like to imitate them in our ministry. The charismatics have their heroes, the guys who can kind of shake out their coats and make people fall down. The megachurches, they have their heroes. You're a successful church, how? Because you have the biggest budget, the biggest number of people, and the biggest amount of baptisms. The Reformed guys have their heroes. They all have really big brains, and they know a lot of things. And then the Anglicans. We have our heroes, don't we? They all have tons of titles stacked up before the beginning of their name. And like the scribes, we imitate and we quote and we stand on the authority of our heroes. But Jesus' preaching was in stark contrast to that, wasn't it? Jesus' teaching had its own authority. Jesus would say, "You have heard it said by the rabbis, but I say unto you by my own authority." Jesus' preaching was striking. It was profound. It was clear. It was powerful. It went right to the heart. When the old Welsh preacher Martin Lloyd-Jones was once asked, "What is the chief end of preaching?" You know what he said? He said, "I like to think it is this, to give men and women a sense of God. A sense of God and His presence in their midst." Well, you can be sure that that is exactly what the hearers sensed at Jesus' preaching. They could detect that the one who was in their midst and who was speaking to them, he not only spoke to them about God like the scribes did, he spoke to them for God. You know, it's interesting because Mark's gospel emphasizes the power of Jesus' teaching. It doesn't emphasize his content. Why? Because he wasn't just imparting information, right? He was affecting his listeners with a sense of God about him, with a sense that God's presence and his kingdom had come near in his proclamation of truth. His goal was not simply to educate, but to regenerate, for the people to be transformed in their innermost beings, or if they would not believe, to be condemned. His word was a fragrance of life unto life for those who believe, but it was a fragrance of death for those who refuse to believe. He left no room for folks to straddle the fence. He spoke with authority. See, when the scribes and the Pharisees taught, they stood on the authority of all these other very intelligent rabbis. But which of them was right? Which one of these rabbis had the seal of God upon him? They all seemed to contradict one another, and it left the people confused. There was a crisis of authority. But when Jesus taught, it was evident. They knew who was in charge, and that is exactly what he came to reassure them. But not only does he do it by the authority of his words, but second, He does it by the authority of his actions. Now, when God created Adam and Eve in the beginning, we're told that he gave them dominion over the earth. He gave them authority to rule and subdue creation. But what soon happens? In Genesis 3, the serpent, Satan, comes into the garden and he tempts them to eat of the fruit that God commanded them not to eat. The devil deceptively convinces Adam and Eve to join him in his rebellion against God. And like the devil, they fell and became sinners. And the result was that they abdicated their rule, their authority over the earth. Satan wrestled the authority out of their hands through deception. And ever since that day, he has exercised his own dark and twisted spiritual authority over the earth and over its inhabitants. Listen to the Apostle John in 1 John 5:19. The whole world lies in the power of the evil one. That's part of the reason you don't see any demons being cast out of people in the Old Testament. The people, unable to mount a resistance, unable to take back the spiritual authority that had first been placed in their father Adam's hands, they were helpless. Until suddenly, there comes on the scene a new Adam. A clash, even a crisis of authority. Look with me at verse 23. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. Now, you've probably read this before, and you've probably read other instances of demons being cast out in the New Testament. But we need to be struck afresh at how shocking this whole scene must have been for these who were present in the synagogue, for these worshipers. If you've been to Israel, you've probably been in the ruins or in a replica of a first century synagogue. If you've not been to Israel, well, we're planning a trip, a Holy Trinity pilgrimage to Israel in the spring of 2022, and you'll have your chance. But a first century synagogue, it doesn't really look too different from a Protestant worship space, except that there were seats kind of all around, and the one who was preaching would unroll the scroll, and he would begin to preach, just like what's happening here. Well, I want you to imagine that's happening here. And somebody you know, or perhaps someone who has been sitting beside you in church for years, all of a sudden just starts screaming out with a loud voice. What do you think you would do? You'd be shocked, right? Just like these folks. You'd say, "What in the world is the matter with John? What's happened to him?" And that's exactly the scene here. Uncomfortable. Well, what's going on? When I was a little boy, my dad used to take me out into the woods to look for snakes. And we often found them under old logs or under old stones. But when we would lift those old logs up or those stones, we'd always see these other wormy, nasty creatures frantically trying to scurry away from the light. That's what's going on here. When this unclean spirit who loves darkness and who had been hiding in this man in the synagogue for who knows how long, when it encounters Christ, it knows that it is exposed and it recoils from the light of his holy presence. It's no different today. Whenever the authority of Christ and the power of his cross is invoked where these evil spirits lurk, there will be a violent confrontation with evil spirits who possess men's souls and rule their lives. I'll never forget the time when I was in India several years ago. My bishop had flown over to see the work we had been doing, and he was going to do some training for our pastors over the next week. Well, we had just had an initial prayer meeting that night for the week ahead, and went to bed at about 9 o'clock. Well, we had recently just purchased some land around there to build an orphanage and a school and a pastoral training facility on. And some of those pastors were walking around the perimeter that night, sprinkling holy oil around it and claiming it for the kingdom of Christ. Well, as they were doing that, all of a sudden, one of the young men walking around the perimeter with them began to scream out, "No, no, no, this is not Christ's kingdom. It's mine, mine, mine. It belongs to me." Well, at 1 a.m., the bishop and I were awakened from our sleep because the pastors were having trouble getting this demon out of this young man and woke us up at 1 o'clock in the morning, still got sleep in our eyes. And I looked over at the bishop and I said, "Bishop, welcome to India." Well, the young man was someone I had known for 6 years. And like people in the synagogue, I was shocked. I knew this young man. I knew he didn't speak a word of English. But when they brought him to us, he was speaking fluent English, saying, "This place belongs to me. You're not welcome here. Leave now. Leave now," as he's trying to punch us and bite us. I learned what these people in this synagogue learned. It is very emotional seeing that happen to someone you know and love. But don't think this kind of thing only happens in the third world today. I've witnessed it multiple times here on our own soil. And the church will continue to experience, in the midst of this dark world, she will continue to experience that so long as we hold Christ high and we glory in His cross. So long as we oppose things like pornography and racism and abortion and all these other moral evils of our day, we will encounter supernatural opposition in the days and the years to come. Because the foul creatures of hell do not like to be challenged. But let me tell you this, they are not afraid of the sheep. They are afraid of the shepherd. They are not afraid of you and me. They are afraid of Jesus. And if you want them to be afraid of you, you had better stay close to Jesus. Well, let's look at this brief exchange Jesus has with this demon as it's recoiling from His holy presence. "What do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" it says, which literally means, "What do we have in common?" It was a rhetorical device meaning, "Leave me alone." The evil spirit wanted Jesus to go away. He could not stand to be in His presence. And then it issues an instinctively cry of dread. "Have you come to destroy us?" You see, it knew that one day, as we see in the book of Revelation, Jesus would sit on His great white throne and hand the devil and his angels over to a final and eternal judgment when He cast them into the lake of fire. And this evil spirit feared that today might be that day. It was terrified. And so then came the final dramatic cry, "I know who you are, the Holy One of God." At the time of it was believed that exact knowledge of someone's name brought a sort of spiritual mastery or a control over them. This was a desperate and really an ill-informed attempt to challenge and subdue Jesus. Not very smart, but it was desperate. And look what happens. With a simple command, "Be silent," literally, "be muzzled, and come out of him." Just that simple. No hysterics. That simple. How? Because this was the same voice, now incarnate here in Jesus, that issued the command for creation to come into existence, for the stars to be flung into the sky, for the mountains to be raised up from the earth, for the water to come this far and do not come any further. This demon had no choice but to leave, but to obey. And convulsing the boy, it came out with a loud cry. And it says the people were absolutely amazed, saying, he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. And then in verse 28, it says, at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region. What's going on here? This is an echo of an Old Testament episode. And what episode is that? Well, we call his name Jesus in English, but in Hebrew, his name is Yeshua, Joshua. He's the new and the greater Joshua. When Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River right before this passage, we're reminded that that is where Joshua crossed over into the promised land all those years before. In his baptism, Jesus crossed the Jordan River, recapitulating, reenacting what Joshua did so long ago. And now what's he doing? But what happened when Joshua crossed the Jordan River in the power and the might of God? You remember, God caused the waters to part and all of Israel marched through them and they began the conquest of the promised land. And what happens? Their fame spread. Word about God's mighty army begins to spread about the land, and the dread of the Lord falls on his enemies as Joshua approached. And now, the greater Joshua has crossed the Jordan. He has now begun the conquest, not simply of some piece of land, but of the cosmos, where Satan has exercised his usurped authority for too long now. And Jesus is the one who's not simply going to win for us a piece of land. He's not just going to defeat for us some temporary enemies. No, he is going to defeat sin, death, and Satan forever. And the casting out of this demon, it is just a little glimpse of that final victory that will soon come by his death, his resurrection, and his coming again in great power and glory. He demonstrates his authority by his words, he does. But he backs them up here by his actions, thereby demonstrating what we said at the outset, that Jesus is in charge. So, little flock, why are you afraid? Been watching too much Fox News and CNN? Too much social media? Got you thinking the government's going to come into your house tomorrow? What's going to happen to my children, to my grandchildren? It is all in the hands of Christ. All in the hands of Christ. Are you willing to trust him with your most treasured possessions? Trust him. Let the government do what it wants. All the combined armies of the world, their strength is like a little gnat beating its head against a world of granite in comparison to Christ. God has set his king on his throne, and he scoffs at the nations that raise their head against his authority. And even if they cause you to suffer and to bleed and to die, it is all according to his providence and will end up in your eternal joy. He is in charge. Well, in closing, Vice President Bush finally arrived at the White House at 7 o'clock in the evening of the shooting when he promptly took control of the Situation Room. And by 8:20, he had gone on television to reassure the nation and the watching world that the American government was functioning and fully effective. Well, I'm here to tell you that the Lord Jesus Christ arrived on this earth 2,000 years ago to assure us that he has taken the government of this world on his shoulders, and it is working fully and effectively according to his plan. The question you have to answer is, what authority will you look to? Is it the church? She'll fail you. Is it a particular minister? He'll fail you. I'll fail you. Is it the government? Is it a political party, a president, or a politician? They'll all fail you. There is only one enduring person and kingdom who will never fail you, and his name is Jesus. And the way you submit your life to his authority is by listening, loving, and obeying his word. That's it. It's that simple. The Christian life is not easy, but it is simple. It is simple. He's in charge. Are you going to submit your life to his authority? That's the question you have to answer. Amen. Let us stand. And in response to the preaching of God's word, let us confess our common faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
These are the prayers. Please be seated. These are the prayers of the people. We pause at the end of each of these so that you can add your own petitions. And if the Holy Spirit leads you to do so, feel free to share those aloud. Let us pray for the church and for the world, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being and unity of the people of God, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, for all ministers, for Foley, our Archbishop, and Frank, our Assisting Bishop, for Ryan, Bubba, Chris, and this humble servant begs your prayers, for David and Lee, our music ministers, and for Carolyn, our parish administrator, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, let us pray to the Lord. In the Anglican cycle of prayer today, we pray for Mission Red Bank in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Lord, in your mercy. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith at home or abroad, let us pray. Lord, in your mercy. For our nation, for those in authority and all in public service, especially Joseph, our president, and Tate, our governor, for the mayors and supervisors and all of the municipalities. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. For all those who've departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, especially Hal Brown, in thanksgiving, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, and for his rising to life again in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know him and make him known, and through him at all times and all places may give thanks to you in all things. Are there other thanksgivings? Lord, in your mercy.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Please rise. Now may the peace of the Lord be always with you. Grant one another peace in a socially distanced manner. On. Good morning and God's peace to you today on this fourth Sunday in the season of Epiphany. We're glad you're here. If you're visiting with us, welcome. Just so you know that at communion, we will have two stations. We will be serving both the bread and the wine at the station here on my left. And if you prefer just the bread, that will be on the station to my right. The way we do the bread and the wine is the priest will have a mask on and he'll have gloves on so that we have no added risk. And what he'll do is he'll just dip the bread and the wine and then drop it on your hands like that. Okay? There's a poster in the back for Jeannie there, 100 Reasons Why We Love Jeannie. And there's still a few spaces there that need to be filled in. So if you can think of a reason that you love Jeannie, please add one of those on there. We'd love to take that to her. Her birthday was on Thursday. Had a wonderful time with her, but we want to get that to her as well. There will be a prayer team. If the Lord has laid any burden on your heart, if there's anything that you are going through right now, the prayer team will be right through these double doors and they'll be there to receive you. Please avail yourself of the prayer team. They're here to serve you, to pray for you, to encourage you. And then there's Ash Wednesday. Get this on your calendar. Ash Wednesday will be the 17th of February, and we'll have two services, one at 12 noon and one at 6 p.m. with the imposition of ashes. There will be no Eucharist in that service. It will just be an imposition of ashes, so the service should probably be 30, 45 minutes, so quite a short service. Lastly, this is the Lord's table. This is not Holy Trinity's table, and all Christians who are baptized are warmly invited to take communion with us. So walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who took on our mortal flesh to reveal his glory, that he might bring us out of darkness and into his own glorious light. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death, we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, for we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are very bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Beloved Christians, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a
Pray together, saying, Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son, heirs of your eternal kingdom. Now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now may the cross of the Son of God, who is mightier than all the hosts of Satan, and more glorious than all the angels of heaven, abide with you in your going out and your coming in, by day and by night, at morning and at evening, at all times and in all places. May it protect you from the wrath of evil spirits, from foes invisible, from the snares of the evil one, and from all low passions that beguile the soul and the body. May the cross of Jesus protect and deliver you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.